begin our worship. Our opening song is We Not Afraid. Spirit.
one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to Sheba, master of the palace, I will thrust you from your office and pull you down from your station. On that day I will summon my servant Eliakim, son of Hilkiah. I will clothe him with your robe and gird him with your sash and give over to him your authority. He shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. I will place the key of the house of David on Eliakim's shoulder. When he opens, no one shall shut. When he shuts, no one shall open. I will fix him like a peg in a sure spot to be a place of honor for his family. The word of the Lord. Lord, your love is eternal. Do not forsake the work of your hands. Lord, your love is eternal. Do not forsake the work of your hands. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with all my heart, for you have heard the words of my mouth. In the presence of the angels, I will sing your praise. I will worship at your holy temple. Lord, your love is eternal. Do not forsake the work of your hands. I will give thanks to your name because of your kindness and your truth. When I called, you answered me. You built up strength within me. Lord, your love is eternal. Do not forsake the work of your hands. The Lord is exalted, yet the lowly he sees, and the proud he knows from afar. Your kindness, O Lord, endures forever. Forsake not the work of your hands. Lord, your love is eternal. Do not forsake the work of your hands. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How inscrutable are his judgments, and how unsearchable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given the Lord anything that he may be repaid? For from him, and through him, and for him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against it. Alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus went into the region of Caesarea Philippi, and he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter said in reply, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus said to him in reply, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my heavenly Father. And so I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly ordered his disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. The Gospel of the Lord. Love one another. Now we know that command all too well. It's kind of the mantra of living out the Christian life, isn't it? It's something that we'll hear in the Gospels time and time again. We'll be reminded of it from weeks, in fact. And when we look at a command of this sort, we find that that love is the motivating factor for any disciple to approach Christ, and the motivating factor for any of us even to live as Christ in the world. In fact, it was love that moved the apostles to follow Jesus when he called them each by name. It was love that inspired Simon Peter today to make his profession of faith in Jesus as the Son of the living God. And certainly we know it was love that led Jesus to the cross to die for our sake. It is love that causes the Christian to seek to do good in the world. And we'll find that Jesus promises us time and time again that if we were to love as he intends, then the world would be completely transformed. But you know, we look out at the world today and we see that we are far from that ideal. And we must come to the conclusion that we do not love as we should. And I think it comes down to the fact that this command to love one another means more than simply doing good acts and being nice to others. Now, love one another means, in fact, to practice love at all times, and only love for others and for God. It doesn't mean simply being nice to our neighbor and then going off on our own behind closed doors and indulging in some secret sins that no one knows about. It doesn't mean being kind to a stranger and to those in authority and then going home and treating our family with disrespect. Perfect love, the kind that Jesus calls us to, is about practicing love at all times to the total exclusion of all sin in every circumstance. And I think that's why none of us can say that I'm good enough. Because we all might do a lot of good things, but none of us are perfect. Every day, each of us sin, each in our own way, each perhaps in little ways. But what we're after in the pursuit of our faith is the total conversion of heart. Each day coming closer and closer to perfection and to the grace of God. The church, of course, there to guide us by articulating a better understanding of the commands of Christ. In the end, it's not about simply doing good. It's about loving God, loving others, doing good, but also avoiding evil. It's about freely choosing to refrain from a life of sin out of love for God, out of a genuine desire for eternal life. And there is the struggle. Because we know sin is a very powerful force in the world. And it has been since sin first entered the world with our first parents, Adam and Eve. You know, we see it all throughout millennia. War, greed, hatred, in all of its forms. All of these are forces that we need to fight against, not just in the world around us, but in our very own hearts as well. And to win this fight, prayer is essential. But so is that firm resolve to never allow sin to rule our lives. And that begins by recognizing the fact that sin is real. And sin is present in our lives. And frankly, some people don't realize that. They don't recognize it. That's why we find that some find nothing wrong with doing violence to themselves or others. There are those who will happily engage in all sorts of behaviors just for the thrill of it. Those who might say they simply don't care, in fact, how their actions affect others or themselves. And before we're too quick to judge and say, well, that's horrible of them, we have to recognize sometimes that even we ourselves can be that person at times. Because we're all sinners who fall short of the glory of God. So what does it take to change? You know, I think everyone is different in a way. For some, it means making a firm resolution to be more mindful of our thoughts and our words and our actions, to discipline ourselves, to seek mercy when we have fallen through the grace of confession. For some, it's most effective if they can look at their lives and realize that they're not fulfilled in the life that they're living, recognizing they need a change, and it starts with rooting out what is not good for us. For others, it means looking to the inspired example of others who have conquered a great deal of sin in their own lives and wanting that kind of victory for ourselves. And then still for others, it requires them to hit rock bottom, experiencing the very harsh and sometimes extreme consequences of their bad decisions. You know, I will often, and I'm sure you've heard it before from me, use the example of St. Augustine from the 4th century as an example of the victorious struggle against sin and the victory won through Jesus. And as Augustine himself reports in his autobiography, The Confessions, you know, he himself had been enslaved to a number of vices and sins throughout his young life. Foremost among them was the sexual sin of lust. And he had spent much of his young life pursuing sexual relationships with a lot of different women over the course of years. But he had a lot of good friends who were Christian. And he was hearing from one particular friend about the freedom and the joy that comes from embracing the life of Christian virtue. And Augustine came to desire that very same holiness. But he'll admit how distressed he was because he realized that his enslavement to sin was just too great. He wanted to change, but at the same time, he also wanted to satisfy that lust within his heart. He experienced what he described as the great agony of hesitation, torn between heaven and earth, wanting to do what's right, but not being able to tear himself away from his carnal desires. And as he struggled to rid himself of his sin, he was haunted by the voices of his past, voices that taunted him and refused to release him. And in fact, as he wrote in his book, he says, "They tugged at the garment of my flesh, and they whispered to me, 'Are you getting rid of us?' And they threatened him by saying, 'From this moment, we shall never be with you again, not forever and ever.'" You know, those voices appealing, of course, to his fear, that the pleasure he gained from that sin was the only joy available to him in this life. So the voices began to tempt him in such disgraceful ways to fall again, and he began to ask himself, "Do I really think I can live without them?" And I think that's the type of fear we confront when we become serious about conversion, about the life of holiness. We begin to face our demons, and we're going to hear those voices within us trying to keep us enslaved to those passions, to those weaknesses, to those sins. But with the struggle comes grace. And with the grace comes the prize. And that prize is the freedom to live as God has originally planned, in perfect loving relationship with Him and with others, something that sin doesn't allow us to do. And just as Jesus declares in the gospel today, whatever is bound on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever is loosed on earth is loose in heaven. If we hold on to sin in this life, we're going to carry that stain with us all throughout this life and into the next, perhaps into eternal loss. But if we struggle to overcome our weakness and our sin, then we become loosed from them on this earth to enjoy freedom like no other, and we can enter into eternity unstained. And that's where our focus needs to be, so that nothing holds us back from running freely into the arms of God and embracing eternal life. You know, each of us has to ask ourselves, what is it that holds me bound to this earth, rather than helping me reach the heights of heaven? For Augustine, it was lust. And maybe for some of us here today, it's the same thing. Maybe for others, it's the sin of anger, or sloth, or gluttony, or greed, envy, or pride, or any number of things. We can become slaves to these things, causing untold anguish within our heart and our spirit. But Augustine's story gives us hope. You know, he would have been stuck in bitter anguish of soul if it weren't for God's grace, which is essential for us to proceed on the spiritual journey. So, as Augustine wept bitterly that he didn't have the strength to change, he describes how he went outside to his garden and he prayed to God. He said, "God, why not now? Why not an end to my impure life in this very hour?" Big questions. Why don't you work right now in my life, Lord? What are you waiting for? But it was that moment that moment when he sincerely desired an end to his life of sin with all of his heart and mind and soul, that was the decisive moment when grace came fully into his life. And he tells us how he heard the voice of a child chanting, "Pick up and read," the voice called. And for Augustine, it was a divine command spoken to the voice of a child. So he rushed to the place in the garden where he laid down his Bible, and he opened it up to a random passage. It ended up being a passage from St. Paul's letter to the Romans that said, "Let us conduct ourselves properly as in the day, not in orgies and drunkenness, not in promiscuity and licentiousness, not in rivalry and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the desires of the flesh." You know, for Augustine, there could not have been more evident or more providential words than those. There was no need now to read any further. All his doubts now were dispelled. All the anxiety he felt about whether he could change disappeared, because he knew that God was with him, and he knew exactly the path that God wanted him on. It was a moment of instant conversion. And the fact of the matter is that God works in each of our lives no less dramatically. You know, just working through some of the ordinary things in our lives. He has the power to transform our lives, to deliver us from the clutches of sin, if only we open ourselves up to him completely and pay attention to the signs he sends us. And perhaps we underestimate the power of God's presence in our everyday lives, and that, of course, would be a shame, because we miss out on the miracle of grace, similar to what Augustine experienced moving from slavery to carnal passions, to freedom and redemption, and then finally marveling at the great mercy and goodness of God. And this is just the beginning of a life immersed in Christ, the beginning of countless marvels that he would do for us. And I think if we should get to that point, and hopefully all of us have or all of us will at some point, then we might express our reaction best as St. Paul did today. Oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How inscrutable are your judgments, how unsearchable your ways. God is mystery, but God is good. You know, how can we possibly understand how God works in our lives to transform us? In the end, we can only marvel. But this transformation begins with that genuine desire, a desire to be holy, and a need come before God, sorrowful for our sins, and wanting and needing to repent, which is the means by which grace enters in. With that comes genuine sorrow for our sins, and then the conversion of our lives. And then finally, when we surrender to that grace that saves, we can then cry out to St. Paul thus today, "To him be glory forever. Amen."
Right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom on earth.
listens to our prayers and answers them according to our needs. For Pope Francis, our bishops, all priests and deacons, for all who hold and teach the Catholic faith, may they, like St. Peter, support others in their faith by never faltering and proclaiming the authentic truth of Jesus Christ as the Son of God. We pray to the Lord. For our nation, that as disagreements and conflicts continue to divide, we may find ways to engage in fruitful dialogue, to reconcile the differences that exist, so that we may establish a true and lasting peace. We pray to the Lord. For a swift end to the current pandemic, for peace in the hearts of all those who fear, and for a greater attentiveness to the needs of our neighbors during this time, we pray to the Lord. For those who struggle to overcome their sins, that they may courageously and humbly approach the sacrament of reconciliation to receive forgiveness of their sins and the strength to resist future temptations, we pray to the Lord. For all students, teachers, and staff who are preparing to return to their classrooms this fall, may they return with the enthusiasm to learn and to grow, and may they remain safe and healthy throughout this coming year. We pray to the Lord. For the souls of all the faithful departed, especially Alvin and Sylvia and Luca, may they know the mercy of Christ and rise with them to new and eternal life. We pray to the Lord. Almighty, eternal Father, you know the deepest needs and desires of our hearts. Hear all these prayers we raise to you this day, and answer them all in accord with your most holy will. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Lift up your hearts.
himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim it. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather your people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory." Mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one Spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Anne and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm faith and charity in your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our Bishop, his assistant Andrew, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family that we have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Ourselves to receive Jesus Christ in the Holy Eucharist today. Let us contemplate the presence of Christ. Let us be like St. Peter today, made a profession of faith in Christ and who he is, to say, Lord, in this Eucharist, it is you, it is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Let us now take a moment to express our desire to be united to him in ever deeper ways. Lord Jesus Christ, I believe that you're in the on Sunday, September 20th. I will be making some adaptations due to the restrictions, but we'll still have a chance to offer a special outdoor mass, weather permitting, a great hog roast dinner for takeout or delivery. There will be cash apples, raffle baskets, painted pumpkins for sale, and some other fun surprises. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that we have a volunteer outside as well today in the parking lot where you get the opportunity to purchase raffle and dinner tickets for Applefest. Raffle tickets for cash prizes up to $2,000 are $30 a piece. Raffle tickets for 49-inch TV are $5 a piece, and hog roast dinner tickets are $12 for adults and $5 for children 10 and under. If you're not prepared to purchase tickets today, or if you don't get the opportunity, we'll continue to offer these sales after masses leading up to